So my task is to summarize and to present the work which we did in this standardization committee, and this is not that the scientists developed something and then we put this into the standard and then this was the standard. We really have very heavy involvement of the industry also at this standardization committee, which is very interesting. So most of the European fabrics manufacturers and many of the solar control manufacturers are part of this committee, and therefore this is not only my work. So my task is to present some insights which are behind this work so that you better understand what has been presented by Hervé Lamy. Okay, so I will talk about insights concerning these transmittance measurements. I will give some insights about glare control and the delta R issue. And then I also will say some few words concerning our vision about product databases and how this relates to the European and US efforts. Okay, so in these standards, for example in the 14501, we have a lot of different transmittance values which we need in order to properly characterize our products. So if these transmittance values are not reliable, or if measurement errors occur, or if results are not comparable between different labs, then we really have a very big problem with many performance characteristics. I don't want to go in detail in these performance characteristics. And what we found, also with the glazing industry, with the International Commission on Glass Technical Committee 10, that there are severe problems with interlaboratory comparisons of measurements. And this shows measurements of different labs for the normal diffuse transmittance. And what we saw is that we have to do something here in order to understand what's going on and to minimize the spread of the results. What we did, commissioned by the European Solar Shading Association, by ESO, together with the German Institute for Textile Research, we did a large study on testing of fabric materials, different materials for solar shading systems, 12 of them, and I want to show only some insights and then I want to go do some conclusions. So we did a lot of measurements and we compared different measurement facilities. So for example, sometimes we also measured with a Goni photometer in order to compare the integrating sphere measurements with these advanced devices for this wide fabric with holes with 3% openness coefficient. And what we found is that if you are careful, you can have a very, very nice agreement between the different measurement systems. So this, the y-axis, this is a large integrating sphere, about 1 meter size. The lower axis is the commercially available small integrating sphere. And the red dots, this is integrated measurements from this goniophotometer. And as you can see, when you do it in the right way, then you can do it correctly and then you can avoid having these problems which were reported before. And sometimes there even might be some additional problems, as you can see here. Here at this point, this is the large integrating sphere and the goniophotometer delivers slightly different results than the small integrating sphere. And this is for thick products, for example. If you imagine, for example, what is this called? Plissé. Plissé, thanks. If you think about a plissé with this thickness, and if you have a light beam on the incident side with a size like this, then the light beam on the other side might be like this. And if your integrating sphere then is like this, you capture only parts of this, and then your result is not big enough. But for the majority of the fabrics, you can really do it correctly if you do it right. And this is contained in this report. And what we can conclude from this is that we tightened up the requirements on measurements in the upcoming standard 14500, and this will have to be respected by the labs. And what is important is the second bullet point. So it's not that we made it very, very complex so that nobody can do the measurements. So we also improved the methods so that you still can use your commercially available measurement system, but if you do the measurements differently, if you put the sample in a slightly different place, then you can still use your commercially available measurement setup. This was important, and this was also an important point, of course, of the manufacturers. They still want to be able to use their measurement devices. But this also means, and this is the third point, if your measurements have been done without these precautions, they might be wrong. So you should check if this has been fulfilled, and of course you don't know what your, if you don't do it by yourself, then you don't know what your measurement provider does. So our advice is ask the provider of your measurements if he already fulfilled the requirements, and if not, your measurement results might be wrong. So please be careful here. So, but we really tried to do it in a way as soft as possible, but we also have to, I go back to this slide. So this was really, really a strong problem. If you see that some people are measuring 0.3 and others measuring more than double the diffuse part of the transmittance, yeah, then this is really a severe problem, and we had to do something here in order to minimize the problems on the market also, because this is also a competitive disadvantage if you have the wrong results. So this is what I wanted to say to concerning transmittance measurements, and afterwards I would be happy to receive questions, but not now. Concerning glare protection, I would like to say that a dramatic increase of know-how has been happened in the last 10 years, and especially because we now better understand how to deal with peaky luminance distributions, like here on this, here on this, you don't see the cursor, only me, sorry. So if you look at this, here you have peaky luminance distributions, and we now can handle this and we can evaluate it. And on the other hand, glare evaluation always contains also the light level on your computer screen. So if the light level on this computer screen is too high, the contrast is reduced so that I cannot see anymore what's on my computer screen. So, and this has really been increased, and before this was not considered in the old version of 14501. The old version of 14501 was based on the old glare rating scheme, which simply was linked to the average brightness of the window. So, and now what we did is we analyzed together with the EPFL in Lausanne, Jan Wienold, we analyzed many cases, and this shows a carpet plot for 1 year. Means January, February, and so on, and this is every hour in the day. And if there's a red color, then there was intolerable glare. If it's in orange, then it was disturbing. If it's in yellow, then it's perceptible. And if it's green, then there was no glare to be perceived. And we analyzed all this, and this is the background of the tables which have been shown previously by Avelami. So we analyzed different locations, different window sizes, and this has then been condensed into the tables shown by Avelami. And we also detected another parameter which might also influence the development of new products on the market, and this is, we call it the cutoff angle. So the blue line is the direct hemispherical transmittance, and the red line is the direct transmittance, so only the light which is going directly through the fabric, and again it's the example of this white fabric with holes. And as you can see, for 75 degrees this direct transmittance drops to zero. So if you look, if the sun is over there, and if you then tilt the fabric, and if the angle of incidence between the fabric and the sun is 75, then you don't see the sun anymore. Then it's really blocked. I don't say blackout. It's really blocked. And this is a characteristic which is strongly influencing these results of the glare. So you get much better glare performance if you have fabrics with lower cutoff angles. And what we said is that if your fabric is able to block the sun already at 65 degrees, then you get a plus of 1 in this table. Then the glare rating for your fabric will be 4 instead of 3 for this case. Okay? And it's important to understand that it's not mandatory to determine the cutoff angle. You can continue as you did, simply with a normal and the diffused component of the transmittance. But if you want to have this improved performance rating, then you have to determine the cutoff angle of your fabric. So it's an option. So to sum up this, first of all, I want to say that all these glare rating criteria, they are based on statistics. So if we say, okay, this is a very good glare rating, then this means that if you have 1,000 people, then only 10% of the people will be bothered by glare or something like that. But this doesn't mean that people with health problems with their eyes, for example, if they have a disease in their eyes, then they need special glare protection. So it's not that we want to say that, forget about them. So, but what we want to say is, this is the statistic value. So if we say, okay, this is a very good glare protection, then it's for the majority of the people, but and not for people with health problems in their eyes. Okay. We have the new optional product characteristic cutoff angle, and in addition to that, in the standard 14501, you will find a new method for a simple determination of the cutoff angle, and this has been developed by DITF, colleagues over there. Good. Then, very brief, Hervé Lamy already talked about the delta R issue. So as we see it, we should be able to take into account also low E coatings of solar control devices. And this can be done easily if we go back to the methods which are already in the standard 15022. It provides solutions for many of the problems, but it needs to be amended. And we also have to simplify these things so that all the manufacturers can do it by themselves. And at the moment, we don't have the money for that in the TG5 group. And we are struggling with this, but this is the situation. So there is a standard which will solve most of the problems, but the last meters to the goal are missing at the moment. So, and last but not least, I just want to show two other slides. I think that people will not accept to buy products based on catalogs or databases with ugly columns and things like that. People want to select from electronic catalogs, and they want to use their iPhone or their Google phone, and they want to place it there, and they want to see if it fits, and they want to see how it looks, and they will use electronic catalogs, and they will not accept to buy furniture from things like this, and solar shading still from these old-fashioned catalogs. So you will have to move in that direction, I'm sure. And this is this black table is a digital twin, so it's not really there. And what we did is, together with one of the largest European construction companies, to go into that direction, and also together with the Technical University of Darmstadt and the civil engineering informatics people, we are trying to find building information modeling, BIM representations, especially also for energetically active building skin components, which means BIPV or building integrated solar thermal, but of course they also have a solar control functionality, and also this solar control functionality is to be represented by this product. And we think that we have to go into this direction, and I think that nobody here in this trade fair is big enough to do it on his own independently and to force all the others to do it. So we have to join forces, and yesterday there were very nice talks, very promising talks. So we are about to start a collaboration with Charlie Kuchia and Steve Sarkovich from LBNL. And we are more than happy to align these efforts with the European ESTA and the European efforts. But I think that we have to move into this direction, otherwise you will have a problem to convince people to use solar control products and to recognize them as being something smart and nice. Yeah, thanks.